Now it gives me immense pleasure to introduce our guest of honor, Dr. Vinod Kumar P, Assistant Professor, Department of Mathematics, TMG College, Tirur. He has acquired his PhD degree from Calicut University. His field of research is functional analysis and operator algebras. He has many research publications in reputed international journals and has presented many papers in international conferences. He is the chief coordinator of Kerala government's Dhanush program to place students in top varsities. Also, he is a member of Ramanujan Mathematical Society. Moreover, he has conducted many online exams for mathematics aspirants, which help the students to acquire mathematical skills and to perform in competitive examinations during this COVID-19 pandemic. And he has got a huge response from all over the world. We are privileged to have you, sir, as a guest of today's session. Over to Dr. Vinod Kumar, sir.
Dear friends, I am Dr. Vinod Kumar P, Assistant Professor, Department of Mathematics, TMG College, Tirur. I would like to thank the faculties of Department of Mathematics, Farooq College, Calicut, for inviting me to deliver a lecture in mathematical analysis in their online bridge course for degree students. The title of my lecture is Introduction to Mathematical Analysis. Mathematical analysis is the critical and careful study of calculus with an emphasis on understanding its basic principles. There are many branches for mathematical analysis, namely real analysis, complex analysis, functional analysis, topology, etc. In my lecture, we will concentrate on real analysis. Real analysis is a branch of mathematical analysis dealing with the real numbers and real value functions of real variables. It includes the study of limits, convergence of sequences, continuity and smoothness, calculus of real functions, etc. Just like our understanding of natural numbers derives from counting, the idea of real numbers originates from conceiving durations of time and lengths in space. Real numbers are numbers that can be expressed as decimals. The real numbers can be represented geometrically as points on a number line called the real line. Thus, the real line is a continuum composed of an uncountable number of points which corresponds to real numbers. Apart from this geometrical view, it is also a set with nice properties, even though there are philosophical questions like Zeno's paradox, whether the continuum can be represented as a set of points. We will now discuss some properties of the set of real numbers. The set of real numbers, which we will denote by the symbol R, is an example of an algebraic structure called ordered field. Let us see what is an ordered field. On the set of real numbers, we have two operations, two binary operations called addition and multiplication, such that the following properties apply. The first property for addition is that for all real numbers xy, x plus y is again a real number. And if x equal to w and y equal to z, then x plus y equal to w plus z. The second property for addition is that for any xy in R, we have x plus y equal to y plus x. This is known as commutative property. The next property is that for any xyz in R, we have x plus y plus z equal to x plus y plus z. This property is known as associative property. The next is that the existence of additive identity. There is a unique real number 0 with the property that x plus 0 equal to x for all x element of R. The fifth property for addition is that for each x in R, there is a unique real number minus x with the property that x plus minus x equal to 0. Here minus x is called the additive inverse of x. Now we will look at properties for multiplication. For all xy in R, x dot y, that means the product of x and y, belongs to R. And if x equal to w and y equal to z, then the product x dot y is the same as the product w dot z. Now, the second property for multiplication is that for all xy in R, we have x dot y equal to y dot x, just like in the case of addition. This property is called commutative property for multiplication. Now, the third property for multiplication is that for all xyz in R, we have x dot y dot z equal to x dot y dot z. This is the associative property. Next is that there is a unique real number 1 with the such that, which is not the same as 0, with the property that x dot 1 equal to x for all x element of R. And this one is called the multiplicative identity. Now, the fifth property, for each x in R with x not equal to 0, there is a unique real number 1 by x such that x into 1 by x equal to 1. So, here 1 by x is known as the multiplicative inverse of x. For each non-zero real number x, we have the multiplicative inverse 1 by x. Now, the property is connecting the addition and multiplication, namely distributive property or distributive law, which says that for all xyz in R, we have x dot y plus z equal to x dot y plus x dot z. That means we can distribute multiplication over addition. This is known as distributive property or distributive law of real numbers. These 11 axioms, 5 axioms for addition and 5 axioms for multiplication, and the distributive law that connects between the operations of addition and multiplication, these 11 axioms are called the field axioms. Any set, so here we are considered about R, if we have any set with 2 binary operations satisfying these 11 properties, such a structure is called a field. So in other words, these properties that we have observed for the set of real numbers illustrates that the set of real numbers forms a field. Now there is another structure in R, namely the order structure. So in addition to the field axioms, the real numbers also satisfies 4 order axioms. You know, there is a natural ordering of real numbers. There is a less than or greater than, that idea is there. So the order axioms that we state for the set of real numbers identify the properties of the relation less than. Remember that A greater than B simply means that B less than A. So we will state all properties with the relation less than, with an understanding that A greater than B means B less than A. The first order axiom, for all xy in R, exactly one of the relations x dot x equal to y or x greater than y or x less than y holds. So for any two real numbers, we have only one of the three conditions, namely x equal to y, x greater than y or x less than y holds. This property is called trichotomy law or trichotomy property. The second order axiom states that for all x, y, z in R, if x less than y and y less than z, then x less than z. This is known as transitive law or transitive property. So if x less than y and y less than z, we have x less than z. The third order axiom is that for all real numbers x, y, z, if x less than y, then we are having that x plus z less than y plus z. The fourth order axiom states that for all x, y, z in R, if x less than y and z greater than 0, then x dot z less than y dot z. If a real number greater than 0, we will usually use to call it as a positive real number. So this fourth axiom states that if x less than y and if z is any positive real number, then x dot z less than y dot z. Now we will state our first theorem, which shows how these axioms may be used to derive some familiar algebraic properties. Let x, y and z be real numbers. If x plus z equal to y plus z, then x equal to y. X dot 0 equal to 0 for any real number x. Minus 0 equal to 0. And minus 1 into x equal to minus x. Let us see how we will make use of these axioms stated about real numbers can be used to prove these familiar algebraic properties. One more property is there, x dot y equal to 0 if and only x equal to 0 or y equal to 0. Another one is that x less than y if and only minus y less than minus x. If x less than y and z less than 0, then x into z greater than y into z. We will illustrate the proofs by doing part A and D. The other parts are left as an exercise for students. So part A is that if x plus z equal to y plus z, then x equal to y. So given that x plus z equal to y plus z, then you add with the additive inverse of z, that means minus z, to both sides of the equation x plus z equal to y plus z. So we get x plus z plus minus z equal to y plus z plus minus z. So z is the additive inverse, that is the fifth axiom for addition. Then you can use associativity. So using associative property, this can be written as x plus z plus minus z equal to y plus z plus minus z. Now additive inverse, using the property of additive inverse, we see that this reduces to x plus 0 equal to y plus 0. And then using the fact that 0 is the additive identity, we can conclude that x equal to y. Thus we have proved that if x plus z equal to y plus z, then x equal to y. Now let us prove the D part. For any real number x, minus 1 into x equal to minus x. Now the question is, what is minus 1? Now minus 1 is the number which when added to 1 gives 0. That means minus 1 is the additive inverse of 1. Now what is minus x? We want to, we note that minus x is the number which when added to x gives 0. That is minus x is the additive inverse. That is the notation for additive inverse of x. So we want to prove that minus 1 into x is equal to minus x. So how do we show that minus 1 into x equal to minus x? Note that minus x is the additive inverse of x. So in order to show that minus 1 into x is equal to minus x, we need only to prove minus 1 into x satisfies the definition of minus x. That means we want to show that when minus 1 into x is added to x, we get the result as 0. So consider x plus minus 1 into x. So you can, using the commutativity of multiplication, you can write it as x plus x into minus 1. Using the fact that 1 is the multiplicative identity, you can write this as x into 1 plus x into minus 1. So using distributive law, you can write this as x into 1 plus minus 1. Now using the fact that minus 1 is the additive inverse of 1, we will get this is equal to x into 0. And then 0 is x into 0 will be equal to 0 by part b that we have already proved. Therefore, the proof is completed because we, in the fifth axiom for addition, we assumed that the additive, there is the existence of additive inverse is uniquely exist. For any real number x, there is an additive inverse minus x which exists uniquely. So here minus 1 into x satisfy the property that x plus minus 1 into x equal to 0, and the additive inverse is unique, so that implies that minus 1 into x is the same as minus x. Any mathematical system that satisfies this 15 axioms, so 11 axioms for a field and 4 axioms for about the order relation. So these 15 axioms, any mathematical system that satisfies these 15 axioms is called an ordered field. So we can conclude that the set of real numbers is an example for an ordered field. But there are other examples as well. The set of rational numbers Q is another example. Now there is one more algebraic property of the real numbers to which we give special attention because of its frequent use in proofs in analysis and because it may not be familiar. So let us state it as another theorem, second theorem. Let x, y be real numbers with x less than or equal to y plus epsilon for every epsilon greater than 0. Then x less than or equal to y. In order to prove this fact, we will establish the contrapositive. By the trichotomy law, the first order axiom, the negation of x less than or equal to y is x greater than y. Thus, we suppose that x greater than y, and we must show that there exists an epsilon greater than 0 such that x greater than y plus epsilon. So the question is, if x greater than y, what positive epsilon can we add on to y so that x greater than y plus epsilon? So here in this picture you can see x and y, and also x is greater than y. Now the question is, what positive epsilon that we want to choose such that x is still greater than y plus epsilon? So for example, you can take your epsilon as equal to half of the distance between x and y. That is epsilon equal to x minus y by 2. Since x greater than y, x minus y will be positive, so epsilon is positive. Furthermore, y plus epsilon will be equal to y plus x minus y by 2. If you simplify it, you will get it equal to x plus y by 2. Now, x greater than y, so if you replace y with x, you will see that this is again less than x plus x by 2, that is 2x by 2, that is equal to x. So we have established that there is an epsilon positive with the property that x greater than y plus epsilon. So this contradiction shows that if x less than or equal to y plus epsilon for every epsilon greater than 0, then x must be less than or equal to y. We now define the absolute value of a real number. If x is a real number, then the absolute value of x denoted by mod x is defined by mod x equal to x if x greater than or equal to 0 and minus x if x less than 0. The basic properties of absolute value are summarized in the following theorem. Let x, y are real numbers and a is positive, then mod x always greater than or equal to 0. Mod x less than or equal to a if and only if minus a less than or equal to x less than or equal to a. Mod xy equal to mod x into mod y. Mod x plus y less than or equal to mod x plus mod y. We will prove only part B and D. The remaining are being left as an exercise for students. So B part, we want to show that mod x less than or equal to a if and only if minus a less than or equal to x less than or equal to a. From the definition of absolute value, we see that x equal to mod x or x equal to minus mod x, so that minus mod x less than or equal to x less than or equal to mod x. If mod x less than or equal to a, then we have minus a less than or equal to minus mod x less than or equal to x less than or equal to mod x less than or equal to a. Conversely, so that part is established. Now for the converse, suppose that minus a less than or equal to x less than or equal to a. If x greater than or equal to 0, then mod x less than or equal to a. And if x less than 0, then mod x equal to minus x, which is again less than or equal to a. Thus in both case, we have mod x less than or equal to a. So that completes the proof of part B. Now look at part D. So here we want to show that mod x plus y less than or equal to mod x plus mod y. So as in part B, we observe that minus mod x less than or equal to x less than or equal to mod x and minus mod y less than or equal to y less than or equal to mod y. Now adding these inequalities together, we will get that minus of mod x plus mod y less than or equal to x plus y less than or equal to mod x plus mod y, which implies that from part B, mod x plus y less than or equal to mod x plus mod y. Here, the part D of this result, that is mod x plus y less than or equal to mod x plus mod y for any real numbers x and y, is called the triangle inequality. Its names come from its being used with vectors in the plane where mod x represents the length of vector x, and if you have vectors x and y, then their sum x plus y, if you represent x and y as sides of a triangle, then x plus y corresponds to the length of the other side. And the triangle inequality then simply says that the length of one side of a triangle is less than or equal to the sum of the lengths of the other two sides. That is why this inequality is called the triangle inequality. Now we will come into the most important axiom satisfied by the set of real numbers, namely the completeness axiom. The completeness axiom roughly says that there are enough real numbers to complete the real line, in the sense that there is no holes or gaps in the real line. This additional axiom distinguishes R from Q. Before presenting this axiom, let us look at why it is needed. Consider the function f of x equal to x square minus 2. Look at the graph of this function. When the graph of this function crosses the horizontal axis at a point between 1 and 2, here in this figure, it is being identified. Now the question is, does that real number, that means the point at which the graph of the function f of x equal to x square minus 2 crosses the x-axis, does that real number exist? How can we be sure that there is a number x on the x-axis such that x square minus 2 equal to 0? It turns out that if the x-axis consists only rational numbers, then no such number exists, because we know that root 2 is not a rational number. Thus, there is no rational number whose square is 2. In fact, we can easily prove that a more general result, that root p is irrational, that means not rational, for any prime number p. Recall that an integer p greater than 1 is a prime number if and only its only divisors are 1 and p. We will prove that if p is a prime number, then root p is not a rational number. We suppose that root p is a rational and obtain a contradiction. If root p is a rational, then you know rational numbers means numbers which can be expressed of the form m by n, where m and n are integers with n not equal to 0. So if root p is rational, we can write root p equal to m by n, where m and n are integers with no common factors other than 1. Then if p square, we will get that p equal to m square by n square, so that p n square equal to m square. So that shows that p must be a factor of m square. Now the prime factored forms of power m and m square have exactly the same prime factors, so we can conclude that p is a factor of m. That is, m will be equal to some k times p for some integer k. But then we have p n square equal to m square and m equal to kp, therefore we will get that p n square equal to k square p square. So cancelling 1p, we will get n square equal to k square into p. Thus p is a factor of n square, and we know that the prime both n and n square have the same prime factors, therefore p is also a factor for n. So that shows that p is a factor for both m and n, contradicting the fact that they have no common factor other than 1. Thus we have proved that root p is not a rational number. We know that there are only uncountably many irrational numbers. Rational numbers are countable, and the set of real numbers is an uncountable set, and irrational numbers is an uncountable subset of the set of real numbers. So if we consider only rational numbers, and if we place it in the real line, in the number line, then we have uncountably many holes in the real line. It is these holes in the number line, that the completeness axiom fails. In order to state the completeness axiom for R, we need some preliminary definitions. We will see what we mean by upper bounds and suprema. If S is a subset of R, then if there is a real number m with the property that m greater than or equal to S for all S in S, then M is called an upper bound of S. And we say that S is bounded above. So, if there is a real number M greater than or equal to S, for all S in S, then M is called an upper bound of S, and we say that the set S is bounded above. If M less than or equal to S for all S in S, then M is a lower bound of S and S is bounded below. The set S is said to be bounded if it is bounded above and bounded below. If an upper bound M of S is a member of S, then M is called the maximum or largest element of S. And we write M equal to max S. Similarly, if a lower bound of S is a member of S, then it is called the minimum or least element of S, denoted by min S. While a set may have many upper and lower bounds, if it has a maximum or a minimum, then these values are unique. Students are advised to prove this fact. Now let us consider an example. S is the subset 2, 4, 6, 8 of the set of real numbers. So these points are marked in the real line 2, 4, 6, 8. Here you can observe that the set S is bounded above by any number, namely 8, or any number bigger than 8 will be an upper bound. And 8 is an upper bound and also 8 belongs to S. So we have maximum of S is equal to 8. Similarly, S has many lower bounds, including 2, which is the largest of the lower bounds. And also 2 is in S, therefore 2 is the minimum of S. It is easy to see that any finite set is bounded and always has a maximum and a minimum. Now consider the example. The closed ray 0 infinity, we observe that it is not bounded above. So, the closed ray 0 infinity is marked in red color in the real line. So, observe that it extends to infinity, starting from 0, extends to infinity. So, it has no maximum, therefore it has no upper bounds, so it is not bounded from above. But it is bounded below by any non-positive number, and of these lower bounds, 0 is the largest. Any number less than 0 is a lower bound of this set, and 0 is the largest lower bound. And also 0 belongs to the set closed 0 infinity, closed ray 0 infinity. So, 0 is the minimum of this set. Now, consider the interval open 0, closed 4. Half open interval 0, 4. This interval has a maximum 4 and this is the smallest of the upper bounds. But here, this set is bounded below by any non-positive number. And of these lower bounds, 0 is the largest. But here, 0 does not belong to our set. So, we can conclude that this set has no minimum. So, in this particular example, this set, even though it is bounded below, it has no minimum. Now, consider empty set. As empty set contains nothing, we can say that empty set is bounded above by any real number M. And also, the condition M greater than or equal to S is satisfied for all S in empty set, because empty set has Nothing. So that m greater than or equal to s is vacuously satisfied. Now that condition is equivalent to the implication that if s belongs to empty set, we need n greater than or equal to s. As empty set contains nothing, this result m greater than or equal to s for all s belongs to empty is trivially satisfied or vacuously satisfied. So you can say that empty set is bounded above by any real number m. So likewise, empty set is bounded below by any real number m. Now we have the definition. If S is a non-empty subset of R and if S is bounded from above, then the least upper bound of S, called its supremum, denoted by sup S. So a real number M is a supremum of S if and only if, first of all, that M should be an upper bound, that is M greater than or equal to S for all S in S, and secondly, if M prime less than M, then there exists an S prime in S such that S prime greater than M prime. That means M prime is not a upper bound for S. So any number smaller than M is not an upper bound of S. So for M to be the supremum of a set, we need that M should be an upper bound, and no number smaller than M can be an upper bound of S. Similarly, if S is bounded below, we can define the greatest lower bound of S. We will call it as the infimum and denoted by inf S. Now, consider the set T consisting of all Q in Q with 0 less than or equal to Q less than or equal to root 2. Does T have a supremum? It depends on the context. If we think of T as a subset of real numbers, then supremum of T exists and it is equal to root 2. But we know that root 2 is not a rational number. So T does not have a supremum in Q. But T have a supremum in R, but not have a supremum in Q. When considering subsets of R, it has been true that each set is bounded above has had a least upper bound. This supremum may be a member of the set, as in the interval 0, 1, there the supremum is 1, 1 belong to that set. Or it may be outside the set, just like half open interval 0, 1, there the supremum is 1, which doesn't belong to that set. But in both cases, the supremum exists as a real number. So if we consider any subset of R which is bounded above, then it always have a supremum. There always exists a real number which is the least upper bound for that set. That point may or may not belong to that set. This is the fundamental difference between the set of rational numbers and the set of real numbers. And it is the basis of our final axiom, namely the completeness axiom. We will state that completeness axiom now. Every non-empty subset S of R that is bounded above has a least upper bound. That is, supremum S exists and it is a real number. So that is a completeness axiom. Every non-empty subset S of R which is bounded above has a least upper bound. That means every non-empty subset of R which is bounded above, we will have sup S, and that sup S is a real number. So this is the completeness axiom. It follows readily from this that every non-empty subset S of R that is bounded below has a greatest lower bound. That means if S is a non-empty subset of R which is bounded below, then infimum of S exists and is a real number. Now, any algebraic structure which satisfies the order axioms, which satisfies the field axioms, order axioms, and this completeness axiom is called a complete ordered field. So we have noted that the set of real numbers forms a complete ordered field. The set of rational numbers Q satisfies the field axioms and order axioms, but it doesn't satisfy the completeness axiom. For example, we have noted this set, the set of all Q in Q with 0 less than or equal to Q less than or equal to root 2 is a non-empty subset of Q, but it does not have a supremum in Q. So Q does not satisfy the completeness axiom. That is, we can conclude Q is a field, an ordered field, but it is not a complete ordered field. So Q is a ordered field which is not complete, and R is a complete ordered field. Now we will illustrate a simple property of supremum. Given non-empty subsets A and B of R, let's C denote the set of all x plus y with x element of A and y element of B. If A and B have suprema, then C has a supremum, and that supremum of C will be equal to supremum of A plus supremum of B. Let us try to prove this result. Let supremum of A equal to small a and supremum of B equal to small b. Now if z is any element of C, you can always write z as x plus y for some x element of A and y element of B. Thus, z equal to x plus y less than or equal to a plus b, because a and b are the supremum of a, the sets a and b. So we are having x less than or equal to a and y less than or equal to b. Therefore, we are having that z less than or equal to a plus b. So that shows that a plus b is an upper bound for the set C. By the completeness axiom, here the set C is bounded from above. Therefore, by completeness axiom, it will have a least upper bound. So let the supremum of C be denoted by small c. We want to prove that supremum of C equal to sup A plus sup B. That is, we have to show that C equal to A plus B. Since C is the least upper bound, and we have noted that A plus B is an upper bound of C, so we conclude that C less than or equal to A plus B. Now, if you can show the other inequality, namely A plus B less than or equal to C, we will get that C equal to A plus B. Now, to prove this A plus B less than or equal to C, we choose any positive real number epsilon. Since A is supremum of A, A minus epsilon cannot be a upper bound for A. So, there must exist a real number X in A with the property that X greater than A minus epsilon. So let us have a picturization for that. So here we have seen the set A. A is the least upper bound of this set, supremum of this set, and epsilon is positive, so A minus epsilon will be smaller than A. Then if you take any number X, you can you can see that this A minus epsilon cannot be an upper bound, so there will be some X in A which is bigger than this A minus epsilon. Similarly, as B is the supremum of B, there always exists some Y in B with the property that Y is greater than B minus epsilon. Here B is the supremum of B, so B is the least upper bound of B, so epsilon is positive, so B minus epsilon will be smaller than B. Therefore, this B minus epsilon cannot be an upper bound, so there will be some y with the property that y greater than b minus epsilon. Combining these inequalities, we see that, so we have x greater than a minus epsilon, y greater than b minus epsilon. So adding, you will get x plus y greater than a plus b minus 2 epsilon. So you are having that x plus y is an element of C, and C is a supremum of C. Therefore, you are having that C is greater than A plus B minus 2 epsilon. That is, A plus B is less than C plus 2 epsilon for every epsilon greater than 0. Now, in the second theorem, we have established that if x less than or equal to y plus epsilon for every epsilon, then we will be having x equal to y. So, using that fact, we can here conclude that a plus b less than or equal to c. So, we have obtained a plus b less than or equal to c. Finally, c is less than or equal to a plus b and c is greater than or equal to a plus b. So, combining them, we will get that c equal to a plus b. Now, we will state an important property of real numbers, namely the Archimedean property. The Archimedean property states that the set of natural numbers is unbounded above in R or not bounded from above in R. The set of natural numbers is not bounded above. That is the Archimedean property. To prove this, suppose that N is bounded above. Then by completeness axiom, it would have a least upper bound. Let us take supremum of N equal to M. Since M is a least upper bound, M minus 1 is not an upper bound of N. So, there exists a number N in N such that N greater than M minus 1. But then N plus 1 greater than M. So, we are having a natural number. Since N is a natural number, N plus 1 is again a natural number. So, we are having a natural number bigger than M. But that is not possible and it contradicts the fact that M is an upper bound of N. So, we can conclude that this N, the set of natural numbers, cannot have a least upper bound. It is not having a least upper bound and it is not bounded above. So, we have established that the set of natural numbers is not bounded above. So, this is known as the Archimedean property of R. There are many other ways to state this property, and this property is widely used in mathematical analysis. We will state many equivalent forms of this as our next theorem, and we will establish their equivalence. In many books, the Archimedean property is being stated as some of these equivalent forms. Each of the following is equivalent to the Archimedean property. First one, for each said element of R, there exists n element of N such that N greater than Z. For each x greater than 0 and for each y element of R, there exists an n element of N such that nx greater than y. For each x greater than 0, there exists an n element of N such that 0 less than 1 by n less than x. We will prove that these three conditions are equivalent to the Archimedean property. So, we shall prove that Archimedean property implies A, implies B, implies C, and C implies Archimedean property. So, that will establish that these three properties are equivalent to Archimedean property. First of all, we will prove that Archimedean property, that means the set of natural numbers is not bounded from above, implies that for each set in R, there exists an n element of N such that N greater than Z. So, look at that property A. What it says, whatever real number set you take, you can always find a natural number bigger than that. Now, let us establish this equivalence. Suppose A is not true, then what happens? That means there is some real number set known with the property that there is no natural number bigger than that. That means we are having that all n is less than or equal to set known. Now, in that situation, set naught will be an upper bound of N. that contradicts the Archimedean property. The set of natural numbers is not bounded from M. So that contradiction shows that A must be true. So we have proved that Archimedean property implies the condition given in A. Now we want to prove that A implies B. That means if we have that whatever real number set you take, there is a natural number bigger than it, then we want to establish that for any real number x greater than 0 and for each real number y, there is a natural number n with the property that nx greater than 1. So here, given that x greater than 0 and y is a real number, so as x is greater than 0, we can consider z equal to y by x, which is again a real number. So from part A, we see that there is a real number n, there is a natural number n such that n greater than y by x. So that implies nx greater than y. So that shows that A implies B. Now we want to prove that B implies C. Given x greater than 0, we want to prove that there is a natural number n such that 0 less than 1 by n less than x. Now in part B, you take y as 1. Then from part B, we will get that there is a natural number n such that nx greater than 1. So that will implies that 1 by n less than x. Now n is a natural number, therefore n greater than 0, therefore 1 by n is also greater than 0. So we are having that 0 less than 1 by n less than x. So that proves B implies C. Now we want to prove that C implies the Archimedean property. That means by assuming C, we want to show that the set of natural numbers is not bounded from above. So assume that for any positive x, there is a natural number n such that 0 less than 1 by n less than x. Suppose that the set of natural numbers n were bounded above by some real number, say m. That is, n less than or equal to m for all n element of m. Now you take k equal to m plus 1. Then you can see that n less than or equal to k minus 1. Because k is m plus 1, therefore k minus 1 is m. So n is less than or equal to k minus 1. Now k minus 1 is less than k. So that will imply that 1 by n is greater than 1 by k for all n. This contradicts C with x equal to 1 by k. So for all, we have obtained that for all natural numbers n, we are having 1 by n greater than 1 by k. So that contradicts part C. So this shows that C implies the Archimedean property. So we have established the equivalence of all these three properties with the Archimedean property. Recall that in first theorem, we proved that root p is not a rational number when p is a prime. We are now in a position to prove that there is a positive real number whose square is p. So root p is not a rational number when p is a prime, but there is a real number whose square is p. So this will illustrate that we have filled the holes in the number line. So we will state the theorem. Let p be a prime number, then there exists a positive real number x such that x square equal to p. Now for proving this, consider the set S consisting of all r in R with r greater than 0 and r square less than p. Since p greater than 1 and 1 is an element of S, we see that S is non-empty. Furthermore, if r is an element of S, then r square will be less than p and p is less than p square. So we see that If we remove the squares, that means taking the square roots, we will get r less than p. So S is bounded above by p. So S is a non-empty subset of real numbers which is bounded from above. Therefore, by completeness axiom of real numbers, we see that supremum of S exists as a real number. Let x be the supremum of S. It is clear that x greater than 0. We claim that x square equal to p. To prove this, we shall show that neither x square less than p nor x square greater than p is consistent with our choice of x. So our set S is the set of all r in R with r greater than 0 and r square less than p, and we have taken x as the supremum of S. We want to show that x square is equal to p. So we want to show that x square less than p and x square greater than p cannot hold. So suppose that x square less than p. So x square less than p, we want to find something positive, say 1 by n, that we can add on to x and still have its square be less than p. This will contradict x as an upper bound of S. So if we can get some 1 by n with the property that x plus 1 by n square is again less than p, we will get a contradiction to the fact that x is an upper bound of S. Now, we assumed that x square less than p. Therefore, you can observe that p minus x square divided by 2x plus 1 is greater than 0. So, by the condition C in theorem 8, an equivalent property of Archimedean property, using that, there exists some natural number n with the property that 1 by n less than p minus x square divided by 2x plus 1. Then, x plus 1 by n square will be equal to x square plus 2x by n plus 1 by n square. That can be written as x square plus 1 by n into 2x plus 1 by n, which is less than or equal to x square plus 1 by n into 2x plus 1, which we get from this inequality. So we are getting that this is less than x square plus p minus x square. So x square and minus x square get cancelled, we get p. So you are having that x plus 1 by n square is again less than p. So that contradicts the fact that x is the supremum of S. So x plus 1 is again, we have established that x plus 1 by n is in S. So that contradicts our choice of x as the upper bound for S. So we have ruled out the case x square less than p. Now suppose that x square greater than p. We want to find something positive, say 1 by n, that we can subtract from x and still have its square be greater than p. This will contradict x as the least upper bound of S. So we want to find out an m such that x minus 1 by m square is greater than p. We assumed that x square greater than p. Therefore, we have x square minus p by 2x greater than 0. So there exists an m in n such that 1 by m less than x square minus p by 2x. Then x minus 1 by m all square on expanding equal to x square minus 2x by m plus 1 by m square, which is greater than x square minus 2x by m, which is again greater than x square minus p. So x square is get cancelled. We are getting p. So we have established that x minus 1 by m square greater than p. So that implies that x minus 1 by m is again greater than r for all r in S. So x minus 1 by m is an upper bound of S. But x minus 1 by m is less than x. This contradicts our choice of x as the least upper bound of S. Finally, since neither x square less than p nor x square greater than p is a possibility, we conclude by the trichotomy law that in fact we get x square equal to p. So we have proved that whatever prime number p you take, you can always find a positive real number x such that x square equal to p. That means root p exists as a real number. Remember that if p is a prime, then root p does not exist in the set Q of rational numbers, but the set of real numbers is very rich and having the square root of any prime numbers. Now we will prove the set of rational numbers is dense in R. That means everywhere in the real line we can have rational numbers. We see the presence of Q in between any two real numbers. More precisely, if x and y are real numbers with x less than y, then there exists a rational number R such that x less than R less than y. This is known as the density property. Let us try to prove this. We begin by supposing that x greater than 0. Using Archimedean property, equivalent condition A, there exists a natural number n such that n greater than 1 divided by y minus x. Here observe that x less than y, therefore y minus x is positive. So 1 by y minus x is a real number. So there is a natural number bigger than that. Okay. So on rewriting it, we get nx plus 1 less than ny. Since nx greater than 0, it is not difficult to show that there is a m in n with the property that m minus 1 less than or equal to nx less than n. It can be observed from the real line. You can see that any positive real number lies between two consecutive positive integers. Any positive real number, okay, if x is any positive real number, you can always find a natural number such that m minus 1 less than or equal to x less than m. So using that idea, we are getting a natural number m in n with the property that m minus 1 less than or equal to nx less than m. But then m less than or equal to nx plus 1, which is less than ny, so that nx less than m less than ny. It follows that the rational numbers r equal to m by n satisfy that x less than r less than y. So we have established that between any two real numbers x and y, there is a rational number r such that x less than r less than y for positive real numbers. Now suppose that x less than or equal to 0. In this case, choose an integer k such that k greater than mod x. Then apply the argument above to the positive numbers x plus k and y plus k. If q is a rational satisfying x plus k less than q less than y plus k, then the rational number r equal to q minus k satisfies x less than r less than y. It follows easily from this fact that the irrational numbers are also dense in the set of real numbers. You are advised to try a proof for it. That is, if x and y are real numbers with x less than y, there exists an irrational number w such that x less than w less than y. So with this, we conclude our lecture on mathematical analysis. we have established some properties of real numbers. The set of real numbers with the binary operations of addition and multiplication satisfies all the conditions for the algebraic structure field, and also it satisfies the axioms, order axioms, and most importantly it satisfies the completeness axiom. So the set of real numbers forms a complete ordered field. Remember that Q is a ordered field but not complete. For further reading about this fact, these ideas, I suggest these three books. The first one is Introduction to Real Analysis by Bartle and Sherbert, and the second one is An Introduction to Real Analysis, John K. Hunter, and the third one is Introduction to Real Analysis by William F. French. The last two books are easily available in Google. You can get PDF of the last two books by searching it in Google. Okay, thank you all.